Hi everyone, this is Hitesh Tripathi. I'm the CEO of TechForSoft Project Consultants LLP. So here we are discussing a topic or rather presenting a topic on how food businesses work and how the consultancy works for food businesses. So as I said, I'll be covering following points in this lecture. Because otherwise it's like my favorite subject and I can keep on continuing talking for this. So we would be covering overview of TechForServe and its journey, various roles in a food consulting company, how we proceed for a project, challenges and milestones in handling projects, scope and opportunity. I believe there are almost more than 500 people in this webinar. And it would be difficult to answer questions directly. So you can follow our link, you can follow our website, you can raise the query, and then we'll be happy to answer to. Now, regarding TechForServe, we are a 2011 established organization, and we were a premier innovation-driven establishment in creating and launching promising food and beverage experiences. It works across food and hospitality industries and help build their dreams. So usually it is considered that food is a primary industry and everybody would want to enter into an industry specifically when there is a slowdown in the market. But then lack of adequate experience and knowledge is making the industry difficult to survive for a lot of players. So that is where the role of TechForServe as a consultancy comes. And we've been in the market for good 9.5 years. And we have experienced that although it seems very lucrative, although it seems very cash rich, but there are a lot of internal challenges within the industry, which for a new entrant is difficult to handle. So we are a specialized consulting firm, and we are a blend of strategy management and innovation consultancy. So we just not execute a plan. We decide a business strategy. And if there is an innovation involved, or if there is a new product development involved, or a new process development involved, we are handholding our clients on that as well. And that is how we support the industry. We also focus on assisting the existing food businesses and help aspiring the newbies to establish a profitable food business. So we are also there when I talk about existing food businesses. We make plans to execute and eliminate the loss makers and promote the profit generator. Expansion phase for our organization is also there, where they are doing significantly good, and they want to develop new products, want to explore new markets, want to expand the phase of operations. We provide all the necessary information, and we take an informed decision. Now, for everyone to get a brief preview, we have shared this corporate profile video in this PPT. It's an embedded video. You can check our YouTube channel called TechForServe and find a lot of relevant information. But for the sake of knowledge for everyone, I'm playing this video here. Thank you. this was it. I'm very sure you would like to watch it again, and you can go through the channel and go through the website again. So now I will be discussing on what various roles a food consultancy company plays. Right. So, various roles which a consulting company can play is there are companies who just work as chefs, maybe work in product development. There are people who provide labor, so they work as labor contractor. There are recipists. There are R&D people, research and development driven. There are quality control departments or organizations which handle the quality control. There are machine agent which help in procuring of machines. There are chartered accountants who develop the business plan, the financial details, and all the other relevant statutory compliances. There are finance planners. There are business strategists. There are brand planners. And brand planner are the one who actually decide how the brand will look like, what will be the brand name, the logo, the brand positioning, the communication, and how the market will conceive your product or brand. The operations planner who execute the operations of the commissioning and thereafter. Marketing planner who decide the marketing strategies, how the product will be marketed, what markets, what target audience, what pricing, what competition, and troubleshooting. So troubleshooting is into the normal routine operations. But Tech4Serve has a unique role that we contribute in all the segments. So we are a combination of all these departments. So that's what makes us very, very apart from our competition. That we don't work on sections of a project. We work from the conceptualization to the complete handover of a project. So we handle all the roles. Now, this is our usual operational chart, or you can see how do we work. So we have two models of working. One is a turnkey model, where we are talking about a new business, and it starts from the definition of the idea and goes to the complete execution. And there is a retainership model. This model holds good for the people who are existing into the business. So let's start the turnkey model. We have the idea definition, where there is an idea which is being defined, and then there is a meeting with the company, with the team in T4S, Tech4Serve. We do a feasibility study of that idea, and there are two outcomes of the feasibility study. Either the idea is feasible or the idea is not feasible. So if we go on the statistics or the data, on a year, we refuse around more than 450 projects because we don't find them feasible. We don't find them scalable or which can generate profits. So we go ahead with the only projects which pass the first feasibility test. And how we do that, there would be a genuine or a logical question that how do we know before even starting the business that if it is feasible or not. So that comes basis our experience as we've been in the industry for quite a long time. So we, before even the business is implemented, we can draw the expectations out of the business. So now after the feasibility study, we create a business plan. And there are three basic legs of a business plan. One is the commissioning plan, which is how the project will be commissioned and executed. The finance and the budget plan, where how the finances and the budgeting will be done. the legal and the statutory plan, wherein the compliances and all the statutory requirements. Now, this commissioning plan, we divide into five phases. Phase one is the planning phase, where the land and the building viability study is done in the planning itself. So it could be a factory, it could be a retail outlet, it could be a QSR, it could be a restaurant, it could be a hotel. So we have to understand that if the particular piece of land which is being considered for the business, is it viable? How is it connected? What is the layout? How will be the drainage? What will be the exhaust systems? All those things. There are a lot of parameters on which we check the land. Then we do the civil and the interior planning, the layout, the flow, the movement, different departments, how will they be divided, and all that. Then we define the product and the menu. So what kind of products or what menu is going to be there. So once you know what is to be manufactured or what is to be sold, then you can only plan on the other parts of the inventory, like the equipment and the process flow and all those things. The brand planning, how the brand will be, what target audience, as I said, what market it will be catering, and the equipment planning. Now the phase two is the implementation phase. So here the commissioning starts. So first the civil and the interior commissioning, then the raw material and the packing material. So since you have the product already defined, then you can decide on what raw materials would be required, what packaging material would be required. So we plan and order them. We do the machinery commissioning. We do the manpower planning. In this stage, we don't recruit 100% manpower. So it's like the planning is done and a few staffs are hired. And then the marketing strategy planning is done, that how will we approach, what kind of dealers, vendors, distributors, channel partners, and all those things. So then the phase three is staff hiring, where the plant is completely installed, equipment are in place, a lot of packing material is in place, raw material has been aligned. So now the staff hiring comes. We also start implementing the software and the IT systems, the logistics planning, and then comes the trial run. So here the mock productions, small demo productions for quality and for streamlining of the product starts, and the business is kind of starting at the phase three. Then there are handholding, so which is like standard operating procedure development, quality system development, streamlining of operations. So these are the things which are required once the business becomes operational. In the retainership model, which is an existing business, up to phase three is mostly completed because they are running businesses. So there we start from phase four and phase five onwards. Now, when I talk about handholding or streamlining of operations, then it could be anything of the phase one to three as well. For example, maybe the software which is installed in the system is not a feasible software or not workable. So then handholding works on the implementation or changes required, or maybe upgradation of the software. Similarly, if suppose the logistics planning is not done accurately or properly, or for the additional support is required in the logistics, so then we support the logistics that way. So this is a basic structure, but then every project is a different project, and there is no thumb rule to execute it. It depends on how the project is moving. Now let's discuss the challenges which come in front of a consulting firm or in terms of handling projects. So the first challenge, as I was just mentioning, every client is unique, requirements are unique, and project is unique. So there is no copy paste in consulting, that we have executed one particular project and then we just have to copy paste, because every market is a different market, every location is different, every clientele is different. In India itself, various regions have various taste attributes. The cost factor plays a major role in a lot of places. The kind of competition is also defines the kind of product or the pricing you can launch. So every project is unique, and there is a lot of research to be done before executing a project. The second challenge is reputation at stake. As I said, we've been in the industry for a good while, and we have executed 75 plus projects. So, and the best part is that so far, none of our projects have failed. So whenever we take a project, we have a reputation at stake that it should not go in a negative way. So that is one challenge for sure. Then the challenge is flexibility in travel, time zones, new demographics every time. Me and my team continuously keeps on traveling. We travel to different cities all across the country. And as you travel, you have different travel times. You might have different time zones. And there are local demographic changes. For example, the weather, the type of food, the kind of language, the basic attribute of people. So it's a, we have to adjust. We cannot be, you know, very rigid on the way we live. Constant brushing up of the knowledge is required. So we can never say that we have learned almost everything. It is never the fact, because it's a vastly changing industry, and it is very, very competition driven, innovation driven. So we have to keep updated ourselves in terms of the knowledge, the new technologies, the new type of products, the new packaging, different norms, different statutory which is coming. So you have to be updated all the time. Competition with unethical and inefficient players. So I mean, this is something which I think all across the industries they suffer with the unethical approach, or the people who are inefficient but they boast of to be efficient. So but then over a period of time, once you build a reputation, then this doesn't really hurt you, because you have decided on the type of players you want to work with, and the type of projects you want to work with. So this challenge automatically, as you grow big and as you develop a good brand reputation, then this challenge slowly and slowly, you know, keeps on fading away. Then there are local challenges. For example, we are working on a couple of projects in Northeast. So there, the approach is very difficult. Logistics is very difficult. Things take a lot of time to travel. The local workmanship is quite poor. The local availability of spares and a lot of essentials is poor. So we have to rely on the next neighboring city, the big city. And these type of challenges will be there. Some places have a lot of load shedding. There are power failures. So some places you don't get a good quality of potable drinking water. So there will be a local challenge in every project. And before we plan to execute the project, these challenges have to be identified and taken care of. So the milestones, we have, as I said, we have an exceptional track record of delivering 75 plus projects. We have experience of across almost all the major cities in the country. I and my team have also a global experience. I myself personally have traveled more than 30 countries. And I keep traveling every year to explore new opportunities in business, to learn something new, to bring out new technologies from the developed countries. Then you meet new and interesting people every day. So as a part of a consultant life cycle, as you travel more, you tend to meet a lot of new people. And a lot of time it is quite interesting, because you meet people of different domains, different interests, and different life cycles. So not restricted to limited profiles, knowledge and domains. So as I often say, why I love this industry the most, because I can work on various domains, and my knowledge and my skill sets has grown drastically compared to my batchmates or the people of my age, because I have worked across so many domains and so many industries. So I have an abundance of knowledge, and the quest keeps on growing. So we like to take challenges. We like to work on new products, new projects which don't exist. So it's something which is a milestone. you learn interesting facts and technology applications every day. It's more or less covered in what I said, that you have to keep on adopting, and every time you work on a project, you find that the previous machine or the previous equipment or the previous packaging you were working on has been upgraded. So you get to learn scope and opportunity. So food consulting has immense scope, as I said, and there is a lack of honest, ethical, and skilled professionals and organizations. And we have made a place as a pioneer in the field, keeping the value and honesty, ethics, and skill to the heart. So this is something which we are really proud of. And as I started from a very small setup in 2011, now we have established a couple of branch offices. One is in Delhi, one is in Bombay. We have office in Lucknow. And we are very well recognized all across the country. So this gives us even more scope, because once you become a brand, a well-known company in the industry, then a lot of existing players, a lot of established players like to work with you. And specifically, if you have a background of you know, good ethics and honest relationships with your clients, then it's always you know, interesting to have explore many opportunities. There is no one organization that covers as much business scope as TechForServe. So as I said in one of my slides, where there are different organizations which work on different individual aspects of a project in parts. But TechForServe is only one organization which is taking care of the entire project. So when the leader is only one, then the project becomes more smooth sailing. I mean, usually we say that no matter what car you are driving, no matter what the size of the car or what the cost of the car, the driver is only one. So if there is one consulting company which is driving the entire project, then obviously the operations are much more organized, systematic, smooth sailing, and there are very, very, very few, I would say, mistakes in the execution of the project. We provide coverage to a diverse sector. So that is again a scope and opportunity for us, that we are not restricted to any specific domain. We have worked across different industries, bakery, beverages, snacking, retail, FMCG, restaurants, QSR, hotels. So I mean, as the size of the funnel increases, then obviously your opportunity increases. We work with underperforming organizations and also with high performing organizations. So as I mentioned, that if there is a project which is loss making, or if there's an organization which is doing good and looking to expand, both can have an opportunity to work with us. Likewise for us as well, I mean, it's an opportunity, but we have to explore the kind of role we get to play and the kind of value we can add. Our services are not limited to organizational size. So yes, this is something, because we are into consulting more out of passion and knowledge. So we don't restrict ourselves to any specific size of the organization, because we have to find something which is interesting and which is fascinating for us to get associated. Benefit with us not only work once, it can work again and again, month after and year after year. So as I said, we have believed in maintaining and developing relationships, and we have honored to our relationships. So it is very, very beneficial that you know, you get to be associated with the same client for a long time, and that gives you a scope of opportunity of expansion and a long-term association. Now this would be interesting for the young brigade, for the students in the colleges who often try to explore the opportunity out of consulting companies. And I get a lot of requests on my various social media platforms, my LinkedIn and my Facebook, for job request. So I mean, it is good that people try to reach out, but then a lot of them lack the actually adequate knowledge on what is a consultancy and how the consultancy works. So I believe once people see this presentation, they would be having a clear idea of how the consultancies work. So now one is that 2008 onwards, when there was a slump in the market and there was a global recession, from that time onwards, the employment in medium and small industries has become more stable. So because a lot of people were laid off in India and abroad, you must have heard about the pink slips in the US. So the big organizations, obviously, they hire more, but they fire also more. So post 2008, the tendency of the market has changed, of this, the psychology of the new brigade has changed, that they want to work with small and medium industries so that they get better growth opportunities and there is a stability, obviously. Now also with the pandemic, there would be a lot of turnarounds in the big big organizations, but the medium and the small organizations which are doing well, which are cash rich, which are doing decent businesses, they will sustain with the kind of manpower they are having. So then there is a quick recognition of work. So in a big organization, you are restricted to a very specific role, and then there is a time lag between your work gets recognized, because your work actually gets the credit for your work goes to your manager, and then his manager, and then their manager. So basically, you get more recognized in a small organization. There are chances to learn on various domains, non-restrictive work profiles. So in big organizations, you get to work only on a specific department. For example, if you're working in quality, then you are always in quality and just monitoring the quality. So it's a very monotonous work domain. Similarly, if you're in operations, then you are given a restricted set of instructions to follow, or maybe in R&D. So your roles are very restrictive. But with a consulting firm, you get to work on all the aspects of businesses, be it procurement, be it commissioning, be it planning, be it operations, be it product development, be it training, be it manpower training, be it IT. So you get to work on a lot of domains. Working in a flat hierarchy, more exposure to decision-making process. Now, with the consulting firm, usually you are directly reporting to your boss, which is somewhere, somebody very senior in the organization. And then you are also directly reporting to the client. So your reporting structure is quite flat. You are not supposed to report to 20 people and then your mail gets to the top management. And when you are more connected to the top management or the decision-making people, then you get exposure to the decision-making process, which I think a lot of people lack when they work in the big organizations, because they are not close to decision-making process, and they are just instruction executors. Excellent platform for budding entrepreneurs. So if you want to become an entrepreneur in future, then this is the best platform, because here you learn all aspects of business. And obviously, traveling and learning different culture comes as a bonus when you work for a consulting firm. So this is basically it. I think, I hope you like it. I would be waiting for the feedback. If there are any queries, you can write into us. You can reach our YouTube channel. You can reach to our Facebook page, or you can reach to our website and write an email to us. Thank you.